You're listening to Comic Reflections, episode 250. I'm your host, Nicholas Prom.
I'm Jeff Barnhart, Master Mold and Sentinel Supreme. What a stupid name.
No, you are wrong. Anyway, Comic Reflections is brought to you by The Outhouse. You can find our show and other nifty content at theouthousers.com. And if you enjoy this program, please subscribe to us on either iTunes or Stitcher. So today, Jeff and I are going to discuss The Incredible Hulk Annual No. 7, cover dated December of 1978, written by John Byrne and Roger Stern, penciled by John Byrne, and inked by Bob Layton.
All right.
So this issue is a little bit infamous.
Is it?
And I will tell you why at the end.
Oh, okay.
It has something to do with John Byrne being an awful person.
Okay.
So we'll just go on with that. So we open with the Angel is at his mountain chateau, and he's watching the Hulk on the news.
Yeah, and there's Walter Cronkite, which Yay! Is interesting. Usually it's an anonymous...
A generic person.
Yeah. He's got a huge TV set
yeah.
that no one saw until, I don't know, 87 or something.
You do know he's rich, so he probably had a custom TV made.
I'm even not sure they could even make him that big, period.
It's also a comic book.
Yeah, that's true.
They didn't have people with wings back then either.
Yeah, but they do it now, so everything's cool.
Yeah. And I love the Angel. I actually really like him a lot, so.
Yeah, he's... It's kind of a more of a smirky Tony Stark, maybe, you know, or something.
You know, he's
more
a
playboy. Than...
Yeah, but he's a good guy, and I don't know, I like him. And I love his girlfriend. I love Candy Southern.
Mm-hmm.
She's maybe my favorite superhero girlfriend ever.
Really?
Yeah, okay. I just love Candy.
Oh, she's easy on the eyes.
Yeah, so. She's great.
Okay, so he gets a call from Bobby Iceman. What's his last name?
Drake.
Okay. I don't know much about the X-Men, I'm afraid. Sorry.
Well, they're superheroes.
Really?
They were born with their powers.
Cool.
Yeah.
Okay. Yeah. They didn't get it, honestly, but being in a gamma bomb explosion or bitten by radioactive spiders. So, I have five on them.
I'm not sure I'm following your train of logic, but okay.
No, I'm being silly.
What?
Yeah, me? Yeah. So, Bobby has a gal friend.
Yeah.
And they want to come up to his cool penthouse.
Yeah.
And visit. So, yeah. Which is cool.
Yeah. And so, the Angel and the Iceman have been kind of out of the X-Men for a while. And previous to this, actually not too far in the past from this, they were in a super team that the Angel sponsored in L.A., the Champions.
Mm-hmm.
It was the two of them, Ghost Rider, Hercules, Black Widow, and Darkstar.
Mm-hmm. All right, back at the Gamma base, we have Doc Samson looking at a guy from CBS giving a report. And
I love Doc Samson, by the way.
Really? I've read him twice.
Yeah.
One, when the Thing fights the a boxer from Beyond Space.
Okay.
You remember this?
I don't know. Was that one that we did?
No, we never did that, but it's one of the things. And he fought the guy and didn't beat him, but the alien was so impressed that he says, okay, I'll let Earth live.
Oh, that's very generous of him.
But every time I see Doc Samson, he gets his butt kicked.
Right. Well, I mean, he was basically created to sort of keep a handle on the Hulk, and he's not at that power level.
No.
But I like him. I just,
I don't dislike him. I just noticed that he gets his butt kicked directly.
He does, you know.
All right, so the reporter thinks that wants to talk to the Hulk, and he thinks he can handle him because he's been to Vietnam and Angola. Angola, this time, if you don't know, was a cesspool of violence. Millions of people died. The Civil War lasted about 20 years. Ugh. So,
thanks.
Yeah. Okay.
I think I'd rather vacation in Florida. Yeah.
Right. Indeed. The Hulk comes out, he's angry, and scares the reporter. Imagine that. And the Hulk pounds Doc Samson on the head, and he drives him through the ground.
Which is great. It's like a Popeye cartoon.
Yeah, and it doesn't really hurt Doc Samson.
No. Yeah, well, because Doc Samson, he's got some gamma radiation in him, hence the green hair and the super strength.
Yeah. Jim, who is the Hulk's companion now,
yeah,
calms him down. So, yeah. Yay.
I love Jim. You know, Jim got AIDS and died?
Really?
Yeah. Like in the like the late 80s or early 90s.
Okay.
I'm like, geez.
Yeah, that's a downer.
Yeah, it is. And I love Jim. Jim's a great character.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. All right, well, back to the honeycomb hideout. Bobby and his girlfriend come in this cool plane.
Yeah, this one, now this plane was the plane that the champions would use.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. And so Bobby shows his new girlfriend, Teresa Sue Bottoms. Teresa, or Terry, is starstruck at the angel.
Right. And in fact, that's the only reason she's even hanging out with Bobby. She found out he knew the angel, and that was it.
Wow.
She's basically giving him the cold shoulder the whole time.
Yeah.
Which is kind of ironic.
Candy's kind of ticked off.
Yeah. Candy is cool.
Mm-hmm.
Love Candy.
Terry's not evil. She just wants to meet celebrities. And
sure.
And who doesn't?
So. But she used somebody to get to it.
Yeah.
To that point. And that's kind of awful.
Yeah. She does say some crappy later on.
But yeah.
We'll get to that.
Yeah.
So they're lounging about the swimming pool. And this hillbilly guy comes up. And with a gun and starts shooting. I'm not sure why he's a hillbilly. Especially since what he turns out to be. But they may... I wonder if cause it can make a Grizzly Adams joke.
Maybe, or just like it's meant to be a dramatic reveal of who it is, and so a guy in a big, in a overcoat and a hat to kind of disguise to kind of who could this be? And then when it's revealed, like, whoa, you know.
Mm-hmm.
So I don't know why necessarily hillbilly, but, you know.
Yeah. Okay. Bobby did not tell Terry that he's the Iceman.
Right.
But he turns into the Iceman, and Angel is kind of, hey, you're going to break your cover. So, nah, you need me. So,
yeah.
Which is kind of cool.
Yeah. And, you know, with the X-Men, the secret identity thing is, like, it's not as big a deal as with...
Superman and all that.
Well, and with just other superheroes, because the X-Men were outlaws anyway.
Yeah.
So...
Yeah.
And also not as high profile.
Mm-hmm. All right. Well, they just beat the crap out of this hillbilly dude. And
they freeze him in the pool.
Yeah. And they're congratulating themselves. And then the guy comes up and he's not just a sentinel. Because they're not worried about sentinels. They can beat him up like crazy. But
yeah,
this is Sentinel Supreme.
Master Mold.
Master Mold. Ugh. God.
Look, here's the thing. Way back in the Silver Age, in like the first Sentinel story arc, the Master Mold was revealed in the climax of that story, and the original Sentinels were only like 10 or 13 feet tall,
mm-hmm.
and the Master Mold was huge, like 50, 100 feet tall, and he was the one building all the Sentinels.
Mm-hmm.
It's an important character. You're supposed to be impressed.
Yeah, but... Just the name. I mean, it looks like you just need a bunch of Clorox to fight him. So,
look, for a character like that was come up with in like 1964.
Mm-hmm.
Look, it's a good name.
I disagree.
So. Well, you're a fart face.
Okay. All right. So they fight and fight and fight and fight.
Yeah.
Iceman is outcolded by the Sentinel.
Yeah.
And then they realize, oh, this is a sentinel of a different nature and all that. And he takes Iceman, and then the Angel, oh, I know where the Hulk is. He's at the Gamma base.
Which is 100 miles or something like that away. Which mm-hmm. is pretty far, really.
Not that you're flying.
Right. So he figures he's going to lead the Master Mold away so the girls will be safe. Mm-hmm. And hopefully maybe the Hulk will be able to destroy the Master Mold. Good plan.
Yeah. The girls watch him go off, and they says, the Sentinel must have grabbed Bobby, now it's after Warren. And here's what Terry says, which ticked me off. Gee, I can see why he'd go after Warren, but why would anybody want Bobby? Ooh.
Yeah, that's terrible.
Isn't he your boyfriend? Oh, well, yeah. She still doesn't know, I guess, that he's Iceman.
Or that he's homosexual.
Is he?
Well, it came out, like, last year in comics. But honestly, it kind of made sense because he always seemed uncomfortable or, like, had trouble with girls.
Okay.
But, like, tried.
Who doesn't?
I know, but, you know, like, a lot of guys who are in the closet, they'll, like, try, you know, because there's social pressure on them and, you know, stuff.
Yeah. Okay. Sentinel, they all go to Gamma Base. The Air Force comes out, and F-104 is one of the coolest planes ever.
Yeah.
So the Sentinel comes down, Doc Samson fights him, and gets beaten up.
If for no other reason than just to write him out of the story.
Yeah. And he's thrown through the air, and he goes past the Hulk, and the Hulk says, "What is all this noise?" He's like my neighbor. Oh god! So he the Sentinel grabs the Angel and takes off. Doc Samson tries to catch the Sentinel, but he fails. I think because he's knocked off. But the Hulk grabs on and holds on. And here comes General Ross. "Hang my ribs," says General Ross, and nobody else ever.
Well, he's saying that because Glenn Talbot is with him and saying, like, "Your general, your ribs haven't fully healed because you've been injured recently."
You know, I knew that and I forgot. Okay.
Yeah.
So, but,
so it does make sense.
Yeah, I guess it does. All right. Okay. And he's gotten old.
Yeah.
Oh, okay.
That happens.
Not in comic books.
Well, anyway. So, but anyway, so the Hulk follows the Master Mold into space.
Mm-hmm.
Did we mention they were going into space?
Yep. Okay. And they're going to, in the 70s, it was cool if you had a base on an asteroid. I don't know why. I think it's boring. A spaceship is better, but it's all, spaceship's been done. Let's put it on an asteroid. That'd be cool. And it never is.
I like asteroid bases. That's why I think Magneto, like when Magneto was just a pure supervillain, like he was best. Not only did he have an asteroid base, he had a volcano base.
No, okay.
Like, that's... Like, does it get more super villainous than that?
No, I guess not. I can't think of anything more villainous. Except for Comcast or something. And high cable prices. Wouldn't that be hilarious? As one of the things that was funny about the Austin Powers was that Dr. Evil was owner of Starbucks and stuff like that. And they had fun with it. And I didn't like Austin Powers. I liked Dr. Evil. Although he's played with the same person, Mike Myers.
Right. Mike Myers is pretty old hat now. Like, oh, God, really? And then, but you're right. Dr. Evil was like the most fun character in those movies.
Yeah. And I liked Scott Evil, too.
Yeah.
Why don't you just shoot him? Here's a gun. I'll shoot him. All right. But... I'll say one thing about Mike Myers, and he doesn't know when to quit. He has a Jerry Lewis disease. He carries a joke over and over and over.
Yeah, and that's
to death.
And that's why his career is over, over, over.
Too bad, because he made some good films.
I like the Wayne's World movies. Those I think I could still watch today.
Because
Wayne Campbell isn't an annoying character with a bunch of dumb catchphrases to the level that, like, say, Austin Powers is.
Right. Mm-hmm. So. And I liked how. So I Married an Axe Murderer.
Sure. I didn't see that one.
That's okay.
Everyone talks about that. I missed that one. So.
Yeah, it was surprisingly good.
Okay.
All right. So all of our heroes are captured by Master Mold. And they're put in these tubes. Unfortunately, the Hulk is put into a tube named Blob. And Angel's an angel and all that.
Well, so, because all the major known mutants of the time, there are tubes for them, including the Blob from the Brotherhood of Evil Mutants.
Yeah, I gathered that, but how insulting.
You know. It's kind of humorous.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Yeah, but Hulk no sees joke.
Right.
He smashes out like, it's paper mache.
Yeah.
So the Hulk hulks out and goes through the space base. And the other two, hey, we need to make a plan. Hulk smash.
Yeah. He definitely does a lot of smashing. He is so hates robots, and so he really wants to smash the Master Mold.
Does he? I mean...
He hates robots. He talks about hating robots. Like, grr, robot! You know, like... you know, but I don't know. It's like, let's, like, get a poll from the listeners. Who hates more? The Hulk hating robots or Conan hating wizards?
Okay. I'll leave that to our listeners. Huh.
So the Hulk is fighting Master Mold and smashing him a bunch.
Yeah, it's pretty cool.
So Angel and Iceman get in on this at some point.
And they're fighting. And Master Mold finally smashes the Hulk.
Yeah, but the Iceman confronts Master Mold. It's like, hey, wait a sec. Since when does a Sentinel laugh or, you know, show emotion? Mm-hmm. And so it's revealed that the Master Mold has the consciousness of Stephen Lang, mm-hmm. who is a guy who revived the Sentinel program and was presumed killed. Mm-hmm. But in the last moments of his life, he was able to transfer his consciousness into Master Mold. Now he's back for revenge.
Yeah. And then Angel says, wait a minute, Stephen Lang is a vegetable.
Yeah.
And no, he's not.
Yeah, basically says Master Mold. And so it gives him that enough moment of like, well, you know, am I really who I think I am, or is I'm just like the carbon copy kind of thing?
Mm-hmm.
And that gives him enough moment of doubt for the Hulk to really strike the coup de grace and smash the crap out of him.
Hulk will smash you just the same. I don't know what my favorite thing he says is, Hulk doesn't speak. The Hulk smashes. I love that. I'm going to put it on my gravestone. 200 years from now, someone discovers this is one the world's out about. 200 years, you think people will know our superheroes of today?
Well, I mean, we know Hercules.
Yeah.
That's thousands of years old.
Mm-hmm.
So it's possible.
Would we know Hercules without the movies?
I don't think I was aware of Hercules movies before I heard of him through like books. So
yeah.
So yes.
Maybe.
Yeah. Yeah. I mean, and like I don't know about the Hulk, but I'm sure Superman will be known.
Yeah.
Because mm-hmm. he's Superman.
Right. Yeah. It'll be interesting to see. We won't know, but.
Or will we?
Yeah. Okay.
Maybe I'll be a brain in a jar.
Yeah. Cool.
Right.
Yeah, maybe we already are.
Man, we're getting really esoteric here.
Yeah.
As
opposed to usual.
Yeah.
So they smash. The Hulk smashes a Master Mold.
Yeah.
And they go off and they see. Oh, here's a
like a Star Wars type escape pod.
Yeah. Actually, looks really really cool.
Yeah, it does.
So I said, how are we going to get out? No, it doesn't work. And they couldn't get it, so...
But they're trying to get the Hulk to go in there with them, and he won't.
Mm-hmm.
But so Iceman throws a snowball at him to piss him off.
Which is the easiest thing in the world to do, is to make Hulk mad.
Right.
You know, no cream in my coffee. You know.
Right. But anyway, they seal up the pod, and he kicks it loose, airlock and all, so they're able to get away.
I love that. It's a great... panel.
Yeah, it's fun. And, you know, Hulk can survive in space. So he just jumps off the ship.
He cannot speak, and without oxygen, he sleeps, you know.
I guess.
Because on the way up there, he passes out, kind of.
Right. Like he needs to breathe. You can gas the Hulk, which is... Yeah, they did that in one of the Spidey and Superman Treasury editions,
yeah.
Where the Hulk appeared, and he fought Superman briefly, and I think Superman tricked him, like, and got him gassed somehow.
Yeah.
And you can't do that to Superman.
Right.
So,
anyway. It was really, yeah, that's a very memorable moment, too.
Yeah.
It was wonderful. I'm seeing the whole...
And John Buscema drew that. And I was like, I think it's the only time you'll ever see John Buscema draw DC characters.
Interesting.
Yeah.
Hmm. So, the Master Mold wakes up, and they saw, I will destroy the escape pods, or I'll just... make them not work, and I'll blow up the base as well.
Yeah.
So, which is what bad guys do when they're about to die.
Right.
So the escape pod leaves and goes to Earth, and they're about to burn up, and so the Iceman ices it over, and And then they get hit by some kind of debris.
Yeah.
And then they land in the water. Iceman makes a iceberg and raft. And they see the explosion of the base. And
and at first, the Angel and Iceman think that the Hulk didn't make it out.
Mm-hmm. But the Hulk was with them all the time.
Yeah, and climbed up on the raft.
Mm-hmm.
And,
yeah, and they're all friendly after.
Yeah.
Why doesn't he ever turn into Banner?
I don't know. It may be at a point where he's not able to turn to Banner at this point. Mm-hmm. There's so many changes with that, you know, so I can't be certain 100%.
Yeah. Okay, so the Hulk said, oh, I'll go back to Gamma Base, which is surprised me.
Sure.
I expected him to, I'm out of here, you know.
Yeah. Well, he wasn't being kept as a prisoner on Gamma Base.
Mm-hmm.
So I think at that point, the Hulk is relatively, you know.
He wants to go back to Jim.
Yeah.
Because Jim is his friend.
Yeah.
And so there's a little bit of exposition at the end. They say, oh, we better get back to our place where the, make sure that Candy hasn't killed Sue by now.
Yeah.
And then Iceman says, why me, Lord? Why me? And then
it's very sitcom.
Yeah, and out of place. And
well, I think sometimes it's kind of like, how do we end this? Like this, you know?
Yeah.
Do like a sitcom freeze frame almost.
Yeah.
I mean, every comic book ends in a freeze frame if you think about it.
Mm-hmm.
It's just the illusion of motion that we have. It's a series of still images. So.
All right. It was a fun read.
Yeah.
I never been bored by a Hulk, and
because they're fun.
Yeah, they're fun. I'm not into X-Men that much because I got into comics after the X-Men explosion, and
sure.
I didn't know where to begin.
Right, right. It's yeah. So about the controversial nature of this issue,
mm-hmm.
John Byrne was very displeased with the way Bob Layton inked this. And I think it was a fine job, and most people would say so, too.
Yeah.
But John Byrne, homophobic creep,
mm-hmm.
thought that the way he inked the characters, especially the lips of the Hulk and the Mastermind, made them look like they're wearing lipstick, and then, to his mind, faggy. Which is just awful. Look for a panel where the Hulk's mouth is actually closed.
There.
Yeah. But look at the Master Mold once. Like, I can kind of see what he's saying, but, like...
That kind of looks like... Yeah, but it's kind of like...
Like here.
I mean, yeah, it's...
But what a weird thing to zero in on.
I mean, like, that's something... Oh, I think he's wearing lipstick. I don't like that. Oh, let's move on. You know, something like that. And to make it a federal case is absurd.
And that's John Byrne. And
yeah.
He is just a crazy, horrible bastard.
Yeah.
But a great artist.
Mm-hmm.
Can't take that away from him.
Most artists you would not want in your house.
It depends. I'd want George Perez in my house. He is a sweetheart.
Yeah. There's exceptions.
Yeah.
But a lot of them, you wouldn't trust your daughter with them. You would count your silver after they left the house. Because that's one thing... I try not to learn anything about artists I like sometimes, like musicians. I just don't want to know. Because
yeah.
It's not going to be interesting. Johnny Cash, interesting. Other people, not so much. You know.
Right. Like, I used to love Ted Nugent, and then I found out what a horrible person he is. And it kind of ruined his music for me. As an example.
Yeah.
But
yeah.
I'm reinforcing your point here.
Yeah. I listened to the Cocteau Twins. I can't understand what they're saying. I found out later they're French, but I decided I don't know what they look like. I didn't know they're French, and so I just listened to music because it was just sounds like the voice of angels singing.
Okay. I know nothing about that group, so I can't even comment.
It's something in the 80s.
So. Okay. So, is that about it?
I guess so.
Okay. Well, Comic Reflections is recorded in Portland, Oregon, and produced by Sean Roof. Until next time.
We'll see you in the funny pages.
In 1994, Mark Waid, Brian Augustine, and Barry Kitson began exploring the beginnings of the world's greatest superhero team over an epic 12-issue comic maxi series. And
guess we've just begun.
That team was the Justice League of America, and that comic was JLA Year One. In 2016, 8 podcasts will come together to cover this series in a single month. That month is JL May. Featuring the Fire and Water Podcast, The Power of Fishnets, Waiting for Doom, The Lantern Cast, Supermates Podcast, The Idlehead of Diabolu, Comic Reflections, and Views from the Long Box. Each podcast will cover one or two issues of JLA Year One, and then coverage will move from show to show. It all starts in the Fire and Water Podcast with issues 1 and 2.
Yes, we've just begun.
JL May, an epic month for an epic series. Available where you find all good podcasts.
The Lonely Hearts Romance Comics Podcast, in which 4 guys talk about romance comics and about romances in comics, with Siskoid.
We're all French Canadians here.
Marty.
In horror comics, there's often like this little, you know, romance tinge, I guess.
Okay.
Bass.
We just turned on him.
And yours truly, Fern.
I'm very aroused.
Featuring the overproduced wonder that is Romance Comics Theater every episode.
Dan, I knew it couldn't last from the first day you eyeballed me when I reported to work. It wouldn't matter if I washed in laundry soap and came to work in a burlap sack. I'd turn you on. And you have the same effect on me.
I do?
The Lonely Hearts Romance Comics Podcast, available at lonelyheartspodcast.wordpress.com and on iTunes.
We've had a comic book romance.
Justice League International, Bwahaha Podcast. A new monthly show chronicling the adventures of the JLI era by Keith Giffen and J.M. DeMatteis will be going issue by issue in release order, tackling the core Justice League title, Justice League Europe, and the quarterly book. Along the way, we'll take time out for special episodes covering various spin-offs, cartoon appearances, the infamous TV pilot, and much more. So join me in an ever-changing roster of guest hosts as we celebrate your favorite JLI members, such as
Martian Manhunter,
Batman,
Dr. Fate,
Black Canary,
Fire,
Ice,
Maxwell Lord,
Oberon,
Captain Marvel,
Rocket Red,
Captain Atom,
Mr. Miracle,
Guy Gardner,
Booster Gold,
Blue Beetle,
Nort,
and many, many more. Justice League International, Bwahaha Podcast, coming March 2016 as part of the Fire and Water Podcast Network. Want to make something of it?
Black Canary.
I'll need a sparring partner.
I'm Zatanna. Why do you care about some leggy dame in nylons? Or have I answered my own question? Ladies and gentlemen, it's time for magic.
Black Canary and Zatanna, together in one podcast. I'm Ryan Daly, and I've got a thing for superheroes in fishnet stockings. That's why I started Power of Fishnets, the Black Canary and Zatanna podcast. Join me every 2 weeks as I celebrate the blonde bombshell and the mistress of magic in their exciting adventures published by DC Comics. Power of Fishnets, available on iTunes and at fireandwaterpodcast.com.
Megatron appears to have time on his side. But when duty calls, they answer, bringing the fight for freedom to the front lines. They are the mystery men and women known as the Justice Society of America.
Hey there, my name is Al Girding, and I have a favor to ask. If you're a fan of the Justice Society of America or other DC Comics Heroes of the Golden Age, please listen to my new podcast, The All-Star Comics Review. Grab your reprints, DC Archive editions, or the original comics if you're lucky enough to own them, and let's explore the adventures of the JSA and other Golden Age greats. Follow along with the All-Star Comics Review podcast, now found on iTunes, allstarcomicsreview.blogspot.com, and Facebook.
Warlord Worlds, a fan podcast devoted to the comic creations of Mike Grell, including Warlord, John Sable, Starslayer, Shaman's Tears, and Green Arrow. I'm Darren.
And I'm Ruth. We hope you'll join us as we discuss the stories, characters, and art in the many excellent comics from writer and artist Mike Grell.
Warlord Worlds is available at podbean.com and on iTunes and Stitcher.
Find us at warlordworlds.com.
Aquaman and Firestorm fighting crime together. Soak them down or burn them up. No one does it better. Whenever you find trouble, they'll always be there to catch them in a bubble or even torch their hair. Stand for truth and justice in sea, on land, and air. Firestorm and Aquaman, they make a super pair.
The Fire and Water Podcast, celebrating Aquaman, King of the Seven Seas, and Firestorm, the Nuclear Man.
Available weekly on Aquaman Shrine, Firestorm Fan, and on iTunes and Stitcher.
I'm one of your hosts, the Irredeemable Shag, here to talk about Firestorm. Along with me is my co-host Rob Kelly, here to talk about some guy that talks to fish.
Really? You're going to pull this crap during the promo? Bad enough, I have to put up with your shenanigans every week, but...
Kalibak, Tassad, it is I, Darkseid. I command you to listen to the Who's Who podcast. Uncover the powers and weaknesses of the Super Friends so that I may destroy them.
Aquaman and Superman, Animal Man and Plastic Man, Firestorm the Nuclear Man, Batman and Hawkman, 2D Man and Hour Man.
Who are all these people, man?
They're all part of the DC Who's Who. Ultra Boy and Mr. Gold, Lightning Lass and Hippolyta, Phantom Stranger, Etrick and Arisian, Woody Winks.
Hey, hey, hey.
What?
What about that one guy?
What guy?
Mr. Pretzel, Mr. Lipstick, Mr. Mitzelfuzzle?
Mr. Mitzi's Pitlick?
Yeah, him.
He's also part of the DC Who's Who.
Who's Who, the definitive podcast of the DC Universe.
Available monthly at Aquaman Shrine, Firestorm Fan, and on iTunes and Stitcher as part of the Fire and Water Podcast.
I'm Mike Gillis.
And I'm Casey Dorn, and we want to ask you an important question.
Are you sick and tired of other panel discussion shows wasting your time droning on and on about foreign policy, economics, and human rights?
Or do you want to hear conversations about things that actually matter?
We host a podcast called Radio Versus the Martians. Every month we gather a panel of our nation's finest minds and plunge a rusty prison shank into the heart of tough questions that have an impact on the lives of real people like you.
Like, are drivers required to pull over for the Ghostbusters?
Is United Federation of Planets actually an oppressive dictatorship run by guidance counselors?
Is Arnold Schwarzenegger secretly a genius?
And are we being mean when we laugh at movies that are so bad they're good?
So write your congressman and let them know that Radio vs. the Martians is available on iTunes, Stitcher, and on RadioVersusTheMartians.com.
Star Wars, give me those Star Wars, nothing but Star Wars, don't let them end. Star Wars, those here in Star Wars, talking about Star Wars on a podcast.
I'm Ryan Daly, and welcome to...
And I'm the Irredeemable Shag.
Dude, what are you doing?
What?
Give me those Star Wars as my show.
Well, you're part of the Fire & Water Podcast Network, so it's really our show.
But if you show up on the promo, people will think you're the co-host.
I'm not?
No, the show will have rotating guests.
You just took that idea from my Justice League International podcast.
You took that idea from my Secret Origins podcast.
And you took that idea from Dead, Both, and Spies.
That was my podcast.
Wait a minute. I sang the theme song with you.
So?
So, technically, I appear on every episode. I'm part of the foundation of this new Star Wars show.
That's true.
So, you want to take this from the top, or what?
I'm Ryan Daly. Join me and a galaxy of guest stars on Give Me Those... including the Irredeemable Shag, whose voice you will technically hear on every episode, on Give Me Those Star Wars.
The official Star Wars show of the Fire & Water Podcast Network.
Available on iTunes and Stitcher and at fireandwaterpodcast.com. Superman, Blue Beetle, Captain Marvel, Firestorm, The Crimson Avenger, Batman, Halo, Guy Gardner, The Sandman, Shadow Lass, Dollman, The Star-Spangled Kid, The Flash, The Phantom Stranger, Power Girl, Hawkman, Fury, The Challengers of the Unknown, Nightwing, The Whip, Johnny Thunder, The Suicide Squad, Deadman, The Spectre, Warlord, Amazing Man, Our Man, Adam Strange, Dr. Occult, The Doom Patrol, Captain Comet, Creep, Green Lantern, Uncle Sam, The Guardian, Batgirl, Dr. Mid, Jonah Hex, Black Khan, The Manhunter, The Guardians of the Floronic, Blue Devil, Dr. Fate, The Legion of Super, The Secret Origins Podcast, covering every issue of DC's Secret Origins comic from the 1980s. Hosted by Ryan Daly and a multitude of guests from the podcast and blogging community. Secret Origins Podcast. Find it on iTunes, Stitcher Radio, and at fireandwaterpodcast.com.